In this video, we will see together what is the purpose of training a tokenizer, what are the key steps to follow, and what is the easiest way to do it. You will ask yourself the question, should I train a new tokenizer? When you plan to train a new model from scratch. A trained tokenizer will not be suitable for your corpus. If your corpus is in a different language, use new characters, such as accent or uppercase letters, as a specific vocabulary, for instance, medical or legal, or use a different style, a language from another century, for example. If I take the tokenizer trained on the BERT-based uncast model, on ignore is normalization step. Then, we can see that the tokenization operation on the English sentence, here is a sentence adapted to our tokenizer, produces a rather satisfactory list of tokens, in the sense that the sentence of 8 words is tokenized into 9 tokens. On the other hand, if I use this same tokenizer on a sentence in Bengali, we see that either a word is divided into many sub-tokens, or that the tokenizer does not know one of the Unicode characters and returns only an unknown token. The fact that a common word is split into many sub-tokens can be problematic, because language models can only handle a sequence of tokens of limited length. A tokenizer that excessively splits your initial text may even impact the performance of your model. Unknown tokens are also problematic, because the model will not be able to extract any information from the unknown part of the text. In this other example, we can see that the tokenizer replaces words containing characters and accents on capital letters with unknown tokens. Finally, if we use again this tokenizer to tokenize medical vocabulary, we see again that a single word is divided into many subtokens, 4 for paracetamol and 4 for pharyngitis. Most of the tokenizers used by the current state-of-the-art language models need to be trained on a corpus that is similar to the one used to pre-train the language model. This training consists in learning rules to divide the text in 2 tokens, and the way to learn these rules and use them depends on the chosen tokenizer model. Thus, to train a new tokenizer, it is first necessary to build a training corpus composed of raw text. Then, you have to choose an architecture for your tokenizer. Here, there is 2 options. The simplest is to reuse the same architecture as the one of a tokenizer used by another model already trained. Otherwise, it is also possible to completely design a new tokenizer, but it requires more experience and attention. Once the architecture is chosen, you can thus train this tokenizer on your constituted corpus. Finally, the last thing you need to do is to save the learn rules to be able to use this tokenizer again. Let's take an example. Let's say you want to train a GPT-2 model on Python code. Even if the Python code is usually in English, this type of text is very specific and deserves a tokenizer trained on it. To convince you of this, we will see at the end the difference produced on an example. For that, we are going to use the method train new from iterator that all the fast tokenizers of the library have, and thus, in particular, GPT-2 tokenizer fast. This is the simplest method in our case to have a tokenizer adapted to Python code. Remember, the first thing is to gather a training corpus. We will use a subpart of the code search net dataset containing only Python functions from open source libraries on GitHub. It's good timing. This dataset is known by the dataset's library, and we can load it in 2 lines of code. Then, as the train new from iterator method expects an iterator list of text, we create the getTrainingCorpus function, which will return an iterator. Now, that we have in iterator on our Python function corpus, we can load the GPT2 tokenizer architecture. Here, all tokenizer is not adapted to our corpus, but we only need one more line to train it on our new corpus. An argument that is common to most of the tokenization algorithms used at the moment is the size of the vocabulary. We chose here the value of 52,000. Finally, once the training is finished, we just have to save our new tokenizer locally or send it to the hub to be able to reuse it very easily afterwards. Finally, let's see together an example if it was useful to retrain a tokenizer similar to the GPT-2 one. With the original tokenizer of GPT-2, we see that all spaces are isolated and the method name random, relatively common in Python code, is split in two. With our new tokenizer, single and double indentation have been learned, and the method random is tokenized into one token. And with that, you know how to train your very own tokenizers now.